exercise we do. Greetings and good evening. My name is James Lewis, and I will be the MC for this evening's event. I'm with the International Space University, and I'm the program director for this year's Southern Hemisphere program. I'd like to welcome everyone here tonight for the International Space University's 2023 Southern Hemisphere Space Stage Program Astronaut Encounter. This event is being held jointly with our longstanding partner here in Adelaide, the University of South Australia. However, before I continue, I would like to acknowledge that where we're meeting is on the traditional country of the Kaurna people of the Adelaide Plains and pay respect to the elders past and present and future. We recognize and respect their cultural heritage, beliefs, relationship with the land. We acknowledge that they are of continuing importance to the people living here today. And we also extend that respect to the other Aboriginal language groups and other First Nations. In addition to the country acknowledgement, it is a pleasure to recognize tonight's event sponsors, Sir Ross and Sir Keith Smith Fund, because without their contributions, obviously, these events are not possible. Tonight, we are welcoming into the audience 38 participants from the 15 nations around the globe that are the participants to the program. We are welcoming a few key special invited guests, as well as, since these events are special, we are open to the public, and so we're excited that the public is here as well. So thank you very much for coming. So really, you're not here to hear me, so we'll get to the meat of the program. So we call this year's event the Astronaut Encounter, and happy to have with us NASA astronaut Rex Walheim. Rex is a retired United States Air Force officer. He's an engineer, and he was a NASA astronaut. Rex flew three space shuttle missions, STS-110, STS-122, and STS-135, where he logged over 500 hours in space, as well as over 36 hours a spacewalk, as we call EVA. Rex was a mission specialist and flight engineer on STS-135, which was, unfortunately, our final space shuttle mission for NASA. Following his flying and orbiting days, prior to his NASA retirement, Rex served as well as chief of the exploration branch of the astronaut office. He was the assistant director for flight operations in the directorate. He was the deputy director of safety and mission assurance at the Johnson Space Center in Houston, Texas. His other experiences over his distinguished NASA career included being CAPCOM, which is capsule communicator in the Mission Control Center. He was chief of the spacewalking branch, and he was the astronaut or crew representative to the Orion program. Rex retired from NASA August of 2020 and has since joined Axiom Space, where he serves as Axiom's chief safety officer. Please join me in welcoming Rex Walheim.
Okay, now, that sound, anybody? Can you guys hear me okay? Nope, still not. Let me try it a little bit closer. Can you hear me now? Yeah, that's better. So we'll get a little bit closer here. How about that? Okay, so we'll try to speak up a little bit there, sorry. Again, my name is Rex Walheim. I'm glad to be here, and thanks for everybody coming out. And I'm going to want to share with you a little bit about what it's like to fly in space. And what I want to do first, though, is I want to talk about how I became an astronaut, because most people think when you become an astronaut, everything must have went perfect in your career. You must have went to the right schools, got the right grades, got the right jobs. And that may be true for some people, but it wasn't true for me necessarily. So what I wanted to start out with, go back one. Sorry, a little bit. I went to school at University of California at Berkeley. And back then, I had the dream of becoming an astronaut, and so I thought I would go the standard route that most people go, or I thought most people went to become an astronaut. They become a pilot, a fighter pilot, then a test pilot, and then become an astronaut. And so I went and I got an engineering degree from the University of California, Berkeley, because it was kind of a good backup in case something happened, because I knew there was always a chance that something could happen. It might not work out as well as you want. And sorry, I'm not getting any. Sorry, we're having a little problem with the slides changing here. David. Can we get you to cycle the slides? This. There we go. Okay, now it's working. Okay, thanks. Sorry. Still not working. You can take an astronaut out of the space shuttle, but you can't take him. What's that? Okay. Okay, yeah, so next slide. Yeah. Okay. So this is where I grew up in California, like I was saying. And go ahead, next slide. And one more. So I got my my commission as a second lieutenant in the Air Force, and I went down to Williams Air Force Base in Arizona. I had my pilot slot. I was supposed to start pilot training. And when I got there, they give you a physical, and I had the military physicals before, but this time the doctors said they found a heart murmur. And a heart murmur is just a little heart condition. It wasn't a health hazard, but they said it was something they wouldn't let me fly with. Next slide. This is what I wanted to do, but when I found I had a heart murmur, next slide, they said, no, you're not going to be able to fly. So it was my grand 15-year plan of becoming an astronaut came off the wheels after about 2 months into it. And so I figured, well, now I can't fly, so I won't become a pilot. I won't become an astronaut, a test pilot or an astronaut. So there's no way I'm going to be able to do my dreams and accomplish this goal that I had. And so I said, well, what should I do now? I figured I'd stay in the Air Force and give it another job as a civilian, as an engineer working in somewhere at the Air Force. And so I said, well, if I stay in, they said I could get out if I wanted to because wasn't able to become a pilot, so I could get out if I want or I could stay in. And so I said, well, originally I thought, well, they kick me, I'll kick them back and I'll get out and go work in Silicon Valley as an engineer. But then I thought, you know, I worked 4 years to become an officer in the Air Force, so I ought to at least give it one more shot. And so I said, well, where will you send me if I stay in? They go, well, we will tell you after you decide to stay, you're going to stay in. So that should have been my first clue. So I called the guy and said, hey, if I get assigned to Space Command, which was where I want to go, where would I go? And he goes, well, probably either Sunnyvale in California or Colorado Springs in Colorado. I thought, well, either of those would be great. So it turns out I did get assigned to Space Command, so I called the guy back a few weeks later, and he said, well, where am I going? And he said, well, it looks like either Omaha, Nebraska, or Cavalier, North Dakota, which were a little bit different. Next slide. So you can see I went to Cavalier, North Dakota. If you've ever heard about North Dakota, it's way up far north in the United States. And so I went up there and worked at a missile warning radar site. It was a very small site. It was only had about 35 people in it, and it was 15 miles from a town of 1,500 people. So it was very much out in the boondocks, we would say, in America. But I decided I was going to do my best I could at my job, and by doing well there, it gave me a jump on my next assignment. It gave me a little bit of a sympathy factor since I was stationed in an isolated assignment. And so I actually got to come down to the Johnson Space Center here in Houston. Next slide, please. And I became a flight controller. I wasn't an astronaut, obviously, because I wasn't a flyer, and I had this medical condition I thought I had. But I was able to at least use my engineering degree now and work as in the Mission Control Center on the Space Shuttle program, which was a lot of fun. And along the way, I heard that I could possibly get to fly as a crew member, not as a pilot, but as what's called a flight test engineer if I was accepted to this school out at Edwards Air Force Base where they train both test pilots and test engineers. So I said, well, that would be great. You know, and they said they'd give me a waiver potentially for this heart murmur they said I had. I could get a waiver and I could fly in the back seat as be a crew member. And so when I was here at the Johnson Space Center, I applied once and didn't get accepted. And so I figured, well, I'll take another assignment in the Air Force. Next slide. And was stationed up here at the Air Force Space Command headquarters in Colorado Springs. And so here, after a couple years later, I tried again to become a flight test engineer. And this time I got accepted. So I went to get my waiver for my heart murmur. And when I went to the Air Force Academy, which was nearby, to get my waiver, the cardiologist said, well, you don't need a waiver because you don't have a heart murmur. Yeah. It turns out that the echocardiograms they used to determine them or had gotten better, and their criteria for what constituted this heart murmur had changed a bit. So in this 5 or 6 years since I'd been at pilot training, it turns out they were telling more people they didn't have mitral valve prolapses, which is this type of heart murmur they thought I had. So at that point, I could have potentially went to become a pilot again, but I'd already been an engineer for about 5 or 6 years, and I'd worked my way up the engineering chain. I figured, no, I'm going to go ahead and become a flight test engineer, go to Air Force Test Pilot School where they train these engineers. And next slide. And I had a chance to finally fly all these airplanes that I wanted to fly, and had a chance to work in the flight test, which was tremendously an exciting experience. And so then I'd been, after I was down at the Johnson Space Center, and I no longer had, when I was down at Edwards Air Force Base, I was no longer had this heart murmur that we were worried about. I figured, well, maybe I'll try my dream again of becoming an astronaut, so I had to kind of dust that dream off again. And so I applied for the first time and didn't get accepted. And then about 2 years later, I applied again. Next slide. And there's me in the class of 1996. So I was able to come down and become an astronaut and start my training down there. Now, the reason I tell that story, like I say, is most people don't say that I want to become an astronaut, so I think I'll get eliminated from pilot training, and then I'll go stand in front of a radar site in North Dakota. That'll set me up perfectly to become an astronaut. But it worked out in my case, because what I found, like to tell people, is sometimes the persistence you pursue a goal with is more important than the path you take. So this is not the path I intended to take, but it worked out for me. Next slide. One of the things we do out at NASA when we train for a mission is we go on what's called a National Outdoor Leadership School. And so that's one of the ways we prepare for a mission, because what we want to do is we want to get to know each other a little bit better, this crew. And so going out someplace which is cold or wet and is physically challenging helps you get together and form a team really well. So one of the first things you do for some of the missions is put us together in this outdoor leadership school. Next slide. Then we're going to go through your training for your various parts of the mission. This is a spacewalk training. Next slide. We do our spacewalk training in what's called the Neutral Buoyancy Laboratory. And it's one of the biggest indoor pools in the world. And you'll see up here, this is a picture of two guys doing a spacewalk in the real space station. And here's folks down in the pool with our divers all around us and stuff. And you'll notice that the space station space station and the space shuttle mock-up here don't look as nice and brand new and shiny as the actual space station does. But what's important is dimensionally, it's almost perfect. So if there's a handrail down here, there's a handrail up there. And it's a very, very, very realistic training facility. Next slide. Another thing we do is we train in the T-38, which is a high-performance jet aircraft. And one of the reasons we train in the T-38 is because all the other simulators are just that, simulators. And if you crash a simulator, it doesn't hurt anybody. And so we have to learn to fly together as pilots and mission specialists and learn to handle real-world emergencies as they occur. Next slide. You can see we can fly them in formation. They're a lot of fun to fly, too, besides being great training tools. Next slide. On launch day, on launch day, about 4 hours prior to mission, we get our launch and entry suits on, and we climb into the astronaut van, and we head out to the launch pad. Next slide. And then we come across the walkway here, and we sit in that small cabin and wait, basically. And you never know for sure what today's going to be your launch day. It's kind of like preparing for a very big sporting event or something and not knowing what day it's going to be on, because there could be mechanical problems, there could be weather delays and things like that. And for us, there was only a 30% chance of go on STS-135, the final shuttle flight, because the weather wasn't looking too good. And so we would sit up there, and you'd think that when you're sitting in the cockpit, you would know exactly what's going on. But they weren't really telling us what was going on. We said, well, you know, can you tell us how the weather's looking? And they go, we're working it. And so so they were trying as best they could to see if they could fit all the criteria they needed to do to allow it to be a go for launch. But when we come down to the T-minus 9 minutes, we do a hold where we pull everybody and make sure that the weather's good and the mechanical systems and all the different computer systems are working properly. And if they are, then you can start the countdown from T-minus 9 minutes. And so, fortunately, after the weather cleared a little bit and they figured it was good enough to go from a weather standpoint, and the shuttle looked good, so we started the countdown at T-minus 9. At this point, I think, oh, well, hey, maybe we really are going today. And so the clock counted down all the way to T-minus 31 seconds. And at 31 seconds, the clock stopped. And I was thinking, what is going on? So we could hear the people on the intercom talking about a failure that occurred. And we're kind of like going, what kind of failure? And what had happened was this this big rotating arm here, this arm has to rotate away from the launch pad before you can launch, because if you don't, you'll take part of the launch pad with you, which is frowned upon. And so this is an oxygen hood that soaks up the extra oxygen that may be floating around. And so they were pretty sure it was rotated back, but they didn't. They had one piece of data that said it wasn't. And so what they decided to do was to look at a camera and swing a camera and make sure it was swung back and that it was out of the way, and indeed it was. So all of a sudden, for 31 seconds, they think, well, we're not going to go because of this problem, because they only have about a minute they can hold there. They're thinking, okay, we're not going to go. And then you could hear them in their voices that sound like they could get it done. And I didn't know exactly at that time what was going on, but it was like, okay, they sound like they know what they're doing. And all of a sudden, they pick up the count. Now, when you pick up the launch count from 31 seconds, it doesn't give you a lot of time to collect your thoughts, you know, so. So next slide. Now, this happens at T-minus 6 seconds. Now, at 6 seconds, the main engines, they start up here. Now, we don't take off because we haven't started these solid rocket boosters here on the side. So for 6 seconds, the main engines burn, and the computers check them to make sure it's operating properly. And if it's operating properly, then right at T-minus 0, the computers will send a command to the white rockets, and you're going flying whether you're ready or not. Next slide. And you jump off the pad. It's an amazing feeling, especially for your first time. The first time you fly, it's really kind of hard to picture yourself as flying in space and getting a chance to do this. And so you kind of think, okay, well, something's going to happen, especially after you know, my background, having my dream of being a pilot pulled away from me. I always have that little doubt and doubting Thomas on the side of your shoulder saying, no, it's not going to happen. You're either going to get sick or something's going to happen. You're not going to pass all your tests or whatever. So you can imagine it's hard to picture yourself that you're ever going to get to fly. So on launch day, when they finally feel that rumble, and then you feel the jolt of being starting to loft into orbit, you're thinking, oh my gosh, this is really it. We'll really get to go today. And it's really an incredible adrenaline rush. And the acceleration is absolutely amazing. You go from 0 to 17,500 miles an hour in 8.5 minutes, so it doesn't take long. Next slide. And we clear the tower. You're going about 100 miles an hour straight up. Next slide. And I'd like to show this picture. This is a picture of my wife and my two boys, Alex and Jeff, and they're watching their dad ride a controlled explosion in the background there. So it's a fun day for us and for them too, but it's, you can imagine it gives them a great deal of concern too. Next slide. And you can see the weather had cleared enough for us to get through the clouds. Next slide. Next slide. And then once you get up to orbit, you can take off the orange suit and wear regular clothes. Next slide, please. And this is a picture of us as we're approaching the space station. And you see this is our logistics module, which has several tons of food, supplies, experiments, and everything for the space station crew. And this is a picture of us from the space station, and we're flying over the Bahamas, which are very pretty from space. Next slide. And this is where we're going, the International Space Station. It's about the size of a 5-bedroom house, and it's an absolutely amazing laboratory in space. Next slide. Now we'll talk a little bit about spacewalking here. This is a picture of me on my second mission, and I'm out on the Columbus Laboratory Module, and we're putting some handrails out there on where they wouldn't fit in inside the shuttle with the handrails. It was that tight of a fit, so we had to put them on afterwards. And talking a little bit about spacewalking, one thing we want to do before we go anywhere is we have our big tether. It's just basically a retractable leash, that kind of like a dog leash would have out in a pet park. But it can go about 30 meters or so, and then you can even go even farther by hooking up a second one and going on further. And so you can see my tether here, and this is one way of doing a spacewalk, which is free-floating. Another way of doing a spacewalk is riding on the end of the robotic arm. There's a robotic arm on the space station. You can click your heels into it, and it can drive you around. Now, one thing about doing a spacewalk is you're going around the Earth every 90 minutes. So for the first 45 minutes, you're in front of the Earth like this, and it's nice and sunny. And then 45 minutes later, it starts getting dark. And so I'll show you a little picture in this sequence here. I'll walk over this area right here, and then it starts getting dark. So next slide. So the first thing I do is turn on my helmet lights, which are these here, and they illuminate an area around me so I can see where I'm working. Next slide. And that's that same area here where I was at night. So you can see it gets a little bit spooky at night, and it's a little bit hard to see. Next slide. This is the crew I had to do the mission with. We have Russian cosmonauts, American astronauts, and a Japanese astronaut, and we're all working together for one as one team. It's one of the best examples of international cooperation that I've ever been a part of. It's really an amazing thing. Next slide. Of course, you got to look out the window a little bit when you're up there. This is a cupola module, which has windows on all sides, and so you can really get a great view from up there. Next slide. Of course, this is one of my favorite places to look at from space. This is California and San Francisco, and I grew up down here in San Carlos. And this is with a little bit of a telephoto lens. You can see San Francisco, the Golden Gate Bridge there, and Alcatraz Island right there. And when I was a kid, I used to sit in my backyard and watch airplanes fly in here to San Francisco International Airport. And here I was flying over 250 miles above at 25 times the speed of sound. It was an incredible, incredible adventure. And I could see my hometown because I knew how to find it. As I looked for this highway here, which is Highway 280, and I looked down at the edge of this reservoir here, go to the other side of the highway, and that would be my hometown. And it worked like a champ. I could see the streets where I grew up in. It was really pretty amazing. Next slide. The cities at night, this is actually London. Next slide. And this is, does anybody know where this is? What's that? Mediterranean, exactly. This is the Mediterranean Sea here. And I like this slide because it shows a lot of different things. It's one of the most beautiful places on Earth from space. Because it's very clear usually, and there's a lot to see here. And then you look at it and think, well, it looks real peaceful, but then you realize this is one of the most war-torn areas in the world. We have Israel, Egypt, Syria, and Iran and Iraq on the edges here, so it's an amazing place. But when you look at it from here, you can see what we have in common, and that's this little blue line right here. And this little blue line from here to here is our atmosphere. That's all it is. And it really does give you appreciation for the fact that the Earth is really fragile. And this is, some people call this the overview effect when you see this, and it really is, it does change your way of thinking when you look at it. Now, one of the other areas that's nice around here, this is Israel, and then this is Egypt over here, is trying to find the pyramids from space. And I told some of the students they've seen this before. Next slide. So they should be able to find this for me here. So what you do is find the Nile River, and you can see the Nile River for about 1,000 miles. It's really pretty easy to see. And then you look at the city of Cairo. This is Cairo right here. And you look where Cairo meets the desert. And right there, next slide. And that's the pyramids right there, so you can see them. So it's an amazing sight. Next slide. After about a week on orbit, we undock from the space station and head home. And to do that, we just basically turn the space shuttle around, fire its engines, and then we drop into the atmosphere. We use the atmosphere to slow us down. Next slide. And this is a picture from the space station of us coming back in. And that's us in the front of that meteor right there. My son did say when he saw this picture afterwards, but it looks like a meteor, Dad. And I go, I'm inside that meteor, Jeffrey. And when you enter during the nighttime, it really feels that way because you can see there's a lot of, you're going so fast, you develop this plasma trail behind you, and it actually looks like a blast furnace inside. There's flames and an orange glow all around the entire shuttle. Next slide. And then the shuttle lands like a conventional airplane. So I'm going to show a short video now, show you a little bit more about this mission. Next slide.
When a generation accomplishes a great thing, it's got a right to stand back and for just a moment admire and take pride in its work.
Okay, Fergie, we're starting to feel pretty good down here on the ground about this one today. So on behalf of the greatest team in the world, good luck to you and your crew on the final flight of this true American icon. And so for the final time, Fergie, Doug, Sandy, and Rick, good luck, Godspeed, and have a little fun up there.
Chris Ferguson, our commander.
Hey, thanks to you and your team, Mike, until the very end. You all made it look easy. The shuttle's always going to be a reflection of what a great nation can do when it dares to be bold and commits to follow through. We're not ending the journey today, Mike. We're completing a chapter of a journey that will never end.
T-minus 9 minutes.
You and the thousands of men and women who gave their hearts, souls, and their lives for the cause of exploration have rewritten history. Let's light this fire one more time, Mike, and witness this great nation at its best.
T-minus 31 seconds due to a fire and an EDSP.
Go ahead.
Yes, sir, we need that to go do the verification per the LCC, please.
T-Mac, the LCC says we need to verify using a camera.
Okay, let us know as soon as 62 is flown over and you can verify LCC for
GDA. This is T-Mac, we verify retracted.
All right, and STE. And STD, STE concurs, they satisfy the requirements of GSC 13 pre-pack contingency, I'm go.
Yes, sir, I heard all that. Concur, press on.
rocket. So now I want to talk a little bit about what I'm doing now, and my colleague Simon Jenner is here with me to help me with this next part of the presentation. We're talking about what we're doing at Axiom Space, the current company I'm working with. Next slide. So we're dividing it into a couple of phases. Our first phase is where we're doing private missions to the International Space Station. And we're the only company that can provide astronaut training using the same facilities and personnel used by NASA, and we can offer 30 and 60-day missions. And so, next slide. We flew our very first mission in April of last year, and this is our crew. We have Larry Connor from the United States, Mark Pathy from Canada, Michael Lopez Alegria from the United States, and Eitan Stibbe from Israel. Now, this is a different type of crew because these people didn't know each other. And when we flew as NASA crews, we obviously knew each other for the most part. So it's an interesting challenge to build a crew out of people who don't know each other and who are very wealthy individuals who may be used to getting their own way and doing their own thing and stuff. So we decided to do the same thing we did with our NASA crews. Next slide. Is take them on an outdoor leadership school course. And so they went and trained together and learned how to work together. And that was a really good experience. It was very cold and wet, and they kind of had to learn to rely on each other and to learn to rely on the leadership of the commander. Next slide. And we also trained at the Johnson Space Center, just like the same facilities that our NASA crews train with. Next slide. And on April 8th of last year, they launched the station. Next slide. And this picture is one I like because it shows the integrated crew. And this is one of the things we're trying to learn on these precursor missions or phase one of our missions at Axiom. We're learning to work together with the NASA crew, and the NASA crew is learning to work together with us. And so they were one big crew, and they worked together and accomplished their objectives. Next slide. And to their credit, our crew members really had a big portfolio of science and research to do while they're on the space station. And they were actually a little bit oversubscribed. They were very, very busy for the first 8 or so days of the mission. Fortunately, they were delayed coming home because of weather, and so that allowed them to do a little bit more sightseeing and having a little bit more fun up there. Next slide. There's Larry taking pictures from the cupola. Next slide. And they came down like a regular SpaceX flight, and they were picked up. Okay, next slide. So that leaves us what's phase two, building onto our modules onto the International Space Station. So beginning in 2025, about 2 years from now, we're going to launch our first habitation module. The habitation module can hold about 4 crew members, and we'll add another one about a year or so later that will have another 4 crew members, and we'll have a crew of 8 up there. And we'll also add the Earth Observatory here, which is a bigger version of the cupola that I showed you on board the space station. And then finally, we bring up the power and thermal module. This allows us to have enough thermal conditioning and power to handle our space station all by ourselves. Up until then, we'll be using some of the resources from the International Space Station. Next slide. And then phase three, once we're complete with the power tower on board our space station, we can detach from the International Space Station and be our own free-flying space station. And we'll do this before the International Space Station is decommissioned. And after that, the NASA crews can come up and visit us in our space station, so we kind of swap roles a little bit. Next slide. Questions. So now we have time for some questions. Anybody have any questions? Yes, sir. No, it's a private company right now. Other questions? Yes. Okay, sounds good. Hold the chairs.
Hey guys, can you hear me? Wonderful.
Simon is a private astronaut recruiter for Axiom Space. So if you're interested in going to space, he's the kind of guy that you got to get comfy with. So.
Hey, who's got the question? We have a microphone?
Thank you for the talk. How did you find sleeping in space? What was your sleeping pattern like?
Well, we conform to what the space station crew was doing, and so we basically Greenwich Mean Time for the most part. So when it was time to go to bed, obviously the sun is still going up and down, and so we'd block out the sun, block out the windows with shields, and then we could get some sleep, hopefully. But it's kind of hard because it's like go, 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 go all day long, and then it's like sleep, and so it's kind of hard to get a good night's sleep. But after a while up there, they sleep pretty well. And we use sleeping bags that we zip up to up around our collar, and we can put our hands out, but we won't float out of them, so we can sleep anywhere on the ceilings, on the walls, or on the floor, wherever we want to.
You sleep in the shuttle when you were docked, or did you sleep in the station?
Yeah, I slept in the shuttle except for days before spacewalks, and I was over on the shuttle. I'm right on the station.
So given how long you spent sort of learning to be an astronaut in the public system of NASA, how do you see this sort of new future for space exploration, which is pretty much a private industry now?
Yeah, so it's a different paradigm, but it's an important one. If we can hand over low Earth orbit to the commercial sector, that allows NASA to concentrate on deep space and going to the moon and going to Mars one day. So it's a good partnership, and it allows us to really take advantage of the entrepreneurial spirit of the commercial sector and combine that with the experience of NASA as we're working with them together. And it really is a good combination. And again, it allows NASA to do what they do best and allows the civil side to do what they do best. I don't know if you have any other comments on that.
I think it's exciting. It starts to open up new economies. So for a very long time, the ISS and space station before that have done a lot of very important basic science. So a lot has been learned about how the human body works in space, a lot has been learned about how materials behave in space, much of which is different, not surprisingly, to how it operates on Earth. But because the ISS is a government vessel, there's not really been the opportunity to commercialize that knowledge. So this is where industry is going to come in and start making changes. Now that we have the understanding of how some of these materials work in space, we can take that knowledge, build stuff in space, bring it back down to Earth. It might have very different performance and improved performance to some materials that can be produced here on the ground. So I think what we'll start seeing is a lot more of that commercial activity when we have these commercial space stations like our station.
Could you please describe to us some of the pre-flight traditions the astronauts would go through?
Pre-flight traditions. Well, they there's a few of them that we do. We have about 2 or 3 days before we launch, we do a family barbecue, which we have our families come out. And even though we're in quarantine, we have them looked at by a doctor, and then they can come out and see us and have a nice barbecue during quarantine. Trying to think of other ones. We're not quite as superstitious as the Russians are. They have quite a few traditions and stuff. But one of the things we did, a little bit of a joke we played on some of the rookie astronauts, is when we were coming into the Astrovan I showed you, we'd drive out to the launch pad, and we'd stop, and we would let out our director of flight operations. And before you go, he goes, "Okay, I need all your boarding passes." And so all the guys who had flown before started digging in their pockets and pull out a plastic that looks like a boarding pass and start to give it to him, and the new guys are going like this. So that one, but don't tell anybody now, so we might remember that. But that's one of our traditions too. But no, so other than that, we're not too many traditions before launch. Except for they do have a tradition of the your last meal before you go fly. They generally, you have like breakfast, and they put it on TV too, so you don't eat too much as you're having this breakfast, because you don't want to see that stuff again later on in the mission if you're not feeling well. But we eat a little bit just because it's better to settle your stomach with a little bit before you go.
I have two questions. The first one is there any commercial use that is not publicly available? Commercial use of commercial investigation or science investigation on Axiom mission in the future that will not be made public because it is confidential, it's commercially viable, and people have been investing a lot and they don't want. Okay, let's start with the first one.
Start with that. So our astronauts generally partner with research organizations. So essentially, our private astronauts are giving up their own astronaut time, which is, as you can imagine, quite expensive normally, in order to give that to research organizations, conduct research on behalf of them. The research organizations generally are going to be the ones that own that data at the end of the day, and it's really up to them whether they make that public. We'd like that to be so, because our astronauts are undertaking research about aging, which can be very useful for understanding how people and humans age here on Earth. It could be research about cancer studies. Of course, we would like to see some of those research be public as well. There's a lot of good research which we'd like to see made public, yes.
I can imagine some new materials you want to first experiment and keep for yourself. I mean, there might be a lot of competition for new materials in space, and it's not immediately made available to public. if there can be an economical return.
Can we keep stuff confidential if we want to? Is that you're saying? Yes. You know, so if we, we would obviously not want to share stuff that is a, a business case for someone else. But
that makes sense. Yeah. At the end of the day, one of the big differences between the government International Space Station and the commercial space station, so we need financially viable. So as part of that, as we open up new markets, we're going to have partners come in who are developing brand new technologies, brand new manufacturing processes, brand new research, and to make us viable, we'll be taking part of those problems.
And the second question is about, is there any plan for future cislunar, lunar, or Martian bases or stations in the Axiom roadmap?
Not currently, but that could be something in the future.
It's worth noting that many of the systems that are required to develop for a brand new space station, low Earth orbit, are very translatable to lunar surface and beyond.
Yeah, does Axiom, well, are they considering a frequent fly program?
I would do a discount for a second flight.
Yeah.
Yeah, I was just wondering, Axiom obviously, built off kind of NASA and everything, but I was just wondering, what was some of the biggest difficulties with, creating sort of a private space company, essentially?
I think one of the difficulties is making sure you can do it and make a profit at the same time. And making it, doing it cheaply enough or inexpensively enough so that you can make a profit. It's, there's a lot of, when you do with NASA, there's a lot of layers of bureaucracy and there's a lot of ways of making sure things are done right because they've been doing it for a long time. But we need to figure out what are the smart ways you can do things cheaper and less expensive but still be safe.
So to give some context around that, it's estimated that put the International Space Station together and install it, cost about $100 billion US, and we're looking to build at least the first stage of Axiom Station, for about 3. So 3% of what the ISS would cost.
Thank you.
So you mentioned that you're in charge of the recruiting of the new astronauts. So what types of criteria and people are you looking to recruit for, like the astronauts and things like that?
So first and foremost, paid experience. We are selling these as customer seats. But beyond that, it's perhaps surprisingly open. We are not looking for people who are in perfect health. We want people who are in good health and good fitness. As for the rest of it, they'll be giving us more than 6 months of their life full time. And during that time, we're going to train them to know everything that they need to know. All the safety systems on board the spacecraft, both the spacecraft taking them to and from the station, as well as the ISS itself, and then future Axiom Station. We'll be training them how to do all the research experiments that they'll be doing whilst on board the station. And all of the emergency drills. So in the event of an emergency, they'll be as trained as any other astronaut that goes up there. What we don't need to train them on is station maintenance. So a big part of the time spent by the NASA and the ESA and the JAXA and Roscosmos astronauts is actually keeping the station going. We're basically just guests up there for a short period of time, so we'll let them do the hard work and we'll just get up there and do some stuff.
And we're looking for people who have good teamwork skills, of course.
Absolutely.
And we want people to be comfortable in uncomfortable situations. We want people who are going to be able to handle the situations, the launch and landing and time in orbit.
It's a good point. And many of the people who we speak to have become quite successful in their own lives, enabled them to have this experience. And in doing so, they've been leaders for most of their lives. So when they're put in a situation where they need to be a follower, part of a crew, and be part of a very close integrated team, we're looking for people that are going to be able to check their ego at the door and become good astronauts, good Axiom astronauts.
Does Axiom have any plans, either now or in the future, to take over the NASA Veggie program and to grow plants in space?
What was the question?
Do we have plans to take over NASA's space program?
I don't know. You know.
So I don't think we're taking over any NASA programs per se. However, there's good knowledge that comes out of that, which we would like to use. Long term, we don't want to have to be shipping all of the supplies to an organization, and we would love to be able to have freshly grown food, but also other medicinal uses for plants that were grown in space available so that we can start to have an ongoing, more sustainable time on the station.
It's a nice tie to Earth, too, is being able to watch your plants grow and actually get to eat some of them, too.
I have a question for our NASA mission. Mm-hmm. So, and this could be a stupid question, but I just want to get it out there. how many kilograms of personal belongings you were allowed to carry on a mission?
How many kilograms of personal belongings? But they had, not including our clothes and stuff, which is packed for us, we're allowed to bring like 10 items or so that we can pack away for people to, you know, to save as souvenirs when they get back. And they also sent up with us a little package with cards and letters from home and stuff and things like that. So it's not very much. I would say it's just a few kilograms most.
With the Axiom missions, we allow crew members 1.5 kilos, basically. And the same thing. It's got to fit into a little container. And most of them bring up little mementos, important stuff of their friends and families, which has extra sentimental value for having gone to space.
You, of course, have talked about your Axiom astronauts being paid customers effectively, but is Axiom looking in the longer term to develop its own cadre of astronauts who belong to Axiom that you hire out to other people?
Yes, so we are trying to build our own core of astronauts. Right now we just have the three of us that are part of Axiom, but we do want to build our own capability to handle more missions as we go on.
When we get to the point where Axiom Station is essentially independent, able to detach from the ISS, that'll be able to handle 8 astronauts full time. But we've got the opportunity to grow that. So as much demand as there for astronauts to conduct research, experiments, manufacturing in space, or even just visiting as private astronauts, we can expand as much as needed.
I have a question. I was curious about how did this experience change your life and the way you approach your job? Because of course, even for an astronaut, it's extraordinary, but let's say it's more, it's part of their job. So since these people were private citizens, how did this change the view of the world and how you, like, your work?
Yeah, I think the experience is very similar whether you're a private astronaut or whether you're a NASA astronaut. And I think that overview effect, which I mentioned, happens to private astronauts too. And as a matter of fact, many of them want that experience. They want to see things differently. And for me, it did change my view of the Earth, like I said, and the fragility of the Earth. But it also cemented more feelings that I already had about my family and about how important it is to be my family, and also appreciation for all the people that had to work so hard to make that possible.
Okay. Hello. My name's Mary. I'm from the Adelaide Planetarium.
Hi, Mary.
And we get hundreds, thousands of children come through, school children come through to the planetarium, many of them wanting to be astronauts. And I understand my question is, what was your experience, first of all, with space nausea? And did you notice any physiological changes even after just clocking 500 hours compared to some of these other astronauts that are up there for 6 months?
Sure. Well, it's an interesting process getting used to going up into space, because you have to get used to being in zero gravity and your body is not used to that. And so for the first few days, you try to eat bland foods and stuff and try to keep your stomach as calm as possible. And one of the ways you do it also is maintain a 1G orientation. So if I went to the space station, if this was the space station right here, and I'm used to training on the ground where this is the floor and that's the ceiling, I would try to stay in that orientation for the first few days, because once you start going upside down, it can throw your vestibular system off and make you ill. So it takes about 2 days or so to get used to that. Some people get very, very sick where they're throwing up. Some people, fortunately, I didn't get that sick. I just got a little bit nauseous, but it wasn't too bad. But it takes a couple days or so to get used to that. Now, When you're coming back, you have the opposite problem, of course, because now you're used to feeling nice and great in zero G, and all of a sudden you feel very, very heavy. And if you move your head around, you get some vestibular effects, and it can cause you to get sick when you get coming down. So you just have to be careful about walking and not moving your head very quickly and things like that. So that'll help you try not to get sick. But it is it's a bit of an adaptation process.
Hey, Rex and Simon. A question about the media component that's going to go on the Axiom space station. How do you see that in terms of you're going to have a media module, my understanding? Yes. Yep. So I know we ask a lot of the science questions and so on, but this is more for the creatives. I want to ask for content creators and artists, how do you see that connection with the media module? And, you know, what were the thoughts in terms of commercialization? Because, you know, for me, that opens a whole another industry.
You want to answer that one?
Yeah, sure. So this is an interesting one. This will be the first module that we are constructing on behalf of the customer. So the C module, Space Entertainment Enterprise, I believe that stands for, is an inflatable module which will attach to our space station. We'll be providing it with the power, any other systems that they require. But essentially, it's going to be theirs to rent out to their customers. So they'll be looking to film movies in there. They will be looking to have concerts, flying famous artists up there for concerts, and sport as well. It's very cool stuff. They are still in their fundraising rounds at the moment. But eventually, it's a big open space, and big open spaces like that can be very multi-purpose. So whatever somebody can dream, I'm sure they're willing to entertain, as long as they don't pop the inflatable module. No sharp stuff, please.
Hi. I just wondered, with Starship expected to launch sometime, I think, this year, I think Musk has talked about that he might be able to get the launch per kilogram down to something like $200. Do you see a future in the next decade or so where sort of every man public will be able to go up in space if they can afford like the $20,000 or something for a ticket?
Well, you're saying, will it get cheaper as it goes on? Is that what you're... Yeah, I think it's going to be a process. The more we do it, the less expensive it'll get. And so I think that's one of the important parts about commercialization, because if you can make money at it, you can do it more often and more frequently. And I don't know if it'll ever get down to, you know, $20,000 or something, but it might. You know, it depends on how things go with the suborbital vehicles too, because, you know, eventually you want to go point to point transportation, and that could be done with suborbital vehicles. And if they can do that cheaply, you know, Elon Musk is trying to do it and other people are trying to do it, then maybe we can get the ticket prices down where people can visit space more freely.
Reg is my name. Thanks very much for your lecture. I got a lot out of that. The space station has an infinite life. I think it's 25 or something, is it? Not 2025 it's going to be decommissioned. Is that right?
NASA's committed to funding the space station until about 2030.
Oh, okay.
The other ISS partners have not committed funding that long yet. So let's say somewhere between 2025 and 2030.
Okay. And my question is, you're using the space station to grow your station and staying tied to it until you're able to break the umbilical cord. Do you know how other private companies are going to develop their space stations? Because you're probably not going to be the only one. Everyone's going to want to get up there. Have you heard how other people are going to grow their space stations?
Yeah, so
do I make myself clear there?
So other companies are trying to build their space stations also, which is good, because our vision is for a thriving low-Earth orbit economy, and the more customers we have there, the more suppliers of space stations, the better, more diverse kind of environment we'll have, I believe.
I think your question was, how are they going to do it? So each of the other serious contenders building a space station is planning to launch it into low Earth orbit, not connected to the ISS or anything like that. Basically, it needs to launch and be good to go from day one. So they'll need to be developing and testing this on ground, and then once it gets to station or into space, they'll get it up there, and each of them, based on the designs I've seen, expects to be able to grow it modularly.
We have time for maybe two more questions.
With many more extended space missions, are there any studies done on the speed and clarity of and analytical abilities of the astronauts in thinking, in particular those who spend more than 1 year in space?
Yeah, so they do have various psychological batteries that they give them to basically gauge their how well they can pay attention and have their attention span and how well they're doing physically or psychologically. So we do that.
Hey, Rex. So your path to becoming an astronaut was, you could say, like unorthodox or whatever. So if you had any tips for someone young wanting to potentially become an astronaut in the future, what path would you recommend them to take or tips you'd give them?
Yeah, well, number one, I'd say find something you love. Because you, in order to be an astronaut, you have to really excel at it and do really, really well. And so your chances of excelling at something are much better if you're doing something you love. And there's a lot of variety of backgrounds that we take for astronauts now, scientists, engineers, pilots, medical doctors. So you find one of those fields that you really interest you and then apply yourself and be persistent. But the most important thing, I think, is finding something you really love so you don't mind working really hard at it.
I think to add to that, most of the young people in the audience today, most of the jobs that are going to exist in space in the future don't exist today. Right now, the astronauts that go up there are trained pretty much to be generalists. Most of the astronauts need to be able to do most of the jobs, whereas as the population of humans that are living in space increases and increases, there is a greater opportunity for people to go there as their specialty. So going on Rex said, if people can find what they love and excel at it, that's probably the greatest opportunity to transition that into a spaceflight experience.
Last question. Okay, thank you for the talk. We just wanted to know, with all these changes in development, what is the youngest possible in your mind for someone to pursue this?
What's the youngest that could go to space? Well, it kind of depends. If you go in the suborbital flights, which you can train in a couple of days and then fly, and they last, you know, an hour or so. They've had, you know, a teenager, I think, was the youngest one who did that.
Yep.
16. So that can be young. Orbital flight is a little more dangerous, and it's a little more complicated, so I think it'd be hard to have someone that young do an orbital flight. So I would say in their early 20s.
Thank you. I think we'll kind of wrap things up right here, right now. There is an opportunity coming for folks to line up. We have pictures of Rex. You can get signed. But first, we have a couple of things. We need the ISU participants. We're going to get a group photo, and then they're going to go up someplace else. And then once we get done with Rex and them, then we'd like to ask the children that are in the audience and then anybody else from the public to get in line. And other than that, we appreciate you guys' time. And we look forward to hearing more about Axiom Space as well. So, thank you.